We're going to be looking at chapter 24, part 2, just the rest of it. There's some stuff in addition to the structure I want to talk about, but let's start off with the structure here. We have different kinds of isomers. There are structural isomers. Structural isomers, the one characteristic that they have is they have different skeletons. Skeletons, usually when you draw those structures, you draw the skeleton of bonds that connect all the atoms and then fill in the rest. And so we have to bond all the atoms first. And in structural isomers, we have different... We have different skeletons. So actually, let me do this since this is hard to read. I'll post this. This is an old PowerPoint I have. Let me just do it here. We'll look at some examples here of structural isomers in addition. Your book breaks these down into different types of structural isomers, but all of them, we're looking at the geometries. All of them have a different bonding skeleton. Let's look at some simpler examples first. So if we wrote this formula, C2H6O, how many different bonding skeletons can we come up with that satisfy the octet rule and formal charge? And it turns out we can come up with two that have zero formal charge and satisfy the octet rule. So one skeleton would be a C-C link to an O. And then we can fill in the rest with H's here. So carbon needs four single bonds, or one double bond and three single bonds, or two double bonds. And then oxygen here will form. So this would be a skeleton here. And then we'd fill in the rest. We have leftover electrons. And so this has two extra electrons. Those would go on to there. And we call this ethanol. The other way we could have come up with this is to throw the oxygen in the middle. This is called a bridging oxygen. Bridging oxygen can link two atoms. We also have terminal atoms. And the terminal oxygen will have a double bond, and it won't link two atoms. So this is what we call a bridging oxygen versus a terminal oxygen. And we can complete the octet there for that. And we come up with this structure. This is called dimethyl ether. So ethanol occurs naturally in the fermentation process. For example, grapes or beer, grapes for wine, fermentation of sugar yields, and hops yields beer. And so ethanol is fine. A lot of people like the smell of ethanol and the taste of ethanol. In high doses, of course, ethanol can be toxic. However, dimethyl ether, a lot of people don't like the smell and don't like the taste, and this is quite a bit more toxic than ethanol. And so these are totally different, even though they share the same formula. And so these are what we call structural isomers. They have a different skeleton, bonding skeleton, and therefore the properties are quite a bit different. Both the chemical properties, this is an alcohol, this is what we call an ether, a COC link is an ether. Their physical properties are different. They have totally different boiling points, melting points, etc. And so their properties are totally different based based on the structure, even though the composition is the same. So for ethanol, we write the condensed structural formula for ethanol. And for ether, we write the condensed structural formula for this so that there's no confusion. We don't write the formulas like this, C2H6O, because for this one, there's only two isomers. But the more carbons you throw on there, the number of isomers increases significantly. And to avoid any confusion, we write structural formulas like this, you know, to indicate that we're looking at these two.
Which one was the bridging oxygen?
Both are bridging oxygens. And so this is a bridging oxygen. It's bridging two. Here. Like that. These are bridging oxygens. The terminal oxygens are like this. So a carboxylic acid would have both a terminal oxygen and a bridging oxygen. The bridging oxygen is an sp3. The terminal oxygen is an sp2 hybridized. So a lot of people just say that's an sp2 oxygen, that's an sp3 oxygen. This is sp2 carbon. A lot of people just label it based on the hybridization, a way they can more mentally picture it as far as geometry goes. All right, so let's look at some examples of complexes here. These two have the same formula, essentially. No. And in fact, we can break it down based on. We got a chromium, five ammonias, one sulfate, and one chloride. And the same thing. Chromium, five ammonias, one chloride, one sulfate. But if you look at this here, the sulfate. What is this? Sulfate, is it a monodentate or a biodentate ligand? I talked about this a while back ago. Can sulfate be a bidentate or tetradentate or whatever ligand? And what is the structure of sulfate? The sulfur is what? Hybridization and sulfate. What I'm going to do is I'm going to do the high formal charge, but not violate the octet. As that's the current thinking in this. Although most structures you'll see have an expanded octet, and that's just historically what people did was they just expanded the octet. And so they put two double bonds here, and that gets rid of the formal charge on sulfur. If we have two double bonds, the formal charge goes to zero on sulfur, which is nice, but as Petrucci says, current quantum mechanical calculations show very little d orbital participation. In this case, for sulfate, if we did do two double bonds, what orbitals would we use? Well, sulfur is sp3, so all the p orbitals are already in use. Normally, when we have a double bond, it's a pp pi bond, but for this, it's got to be a pd pi bond, the p orbital on oxygen, because oxygen is sp2, so that leaves an unhybridized p orbital bonding to an unhybridized d orbital on sulfur. And based on those calculations, they say the d orbital participation in this is minimal. And so the current thinking is something like this, you know. Where we definitely have to expand, that is when we have more than four things attached, then they're saying the extras, like, for example, in trigonal bipyramidal structures or octahedral structures, when we have more than four ligands or more than four atoms, in this case atoms, then we have to ionically bond the extras. All right, so based on this, what would you say? Is it going to be a bidentate or a monodentate ligand? So this is bonding to chromium. bidentate or monodentate? You might think bidentate because it kind of orients like this. This is at 109. And so you might say, okay, this lone pair attacks here, this lone pair attacks here. And so it's bidentate. If it's bidentate, we get a structure like this. You know, we have this bridging oxygen going to the chromium here. This is also a terminal oxygen, but this one is a terminal oxygen with a single bond. A terminal oxygen with a single bond is going to carry a negative charge to it. We could try to double bond it, but that's going to expand the octet, which may not be correct according to more recent research. So if we form a bidentate attachment, it can't be tetradentate or tridentate because these are on the opposite side. You know, when we look at this, when we draw a tetrahedral, we use wedge dash diagrams. So I'm going to wedge that out and dash that in. Wedge this one out, dash this in. So we might have something like this. But the problem, do you see the problem with this? The problem has to do with ring strain. Remind me what ring strain is again, since it's been a while since we talked about it. We talked about this at the very beginning of the semester. We only have 2 weeks, so this is what, the 15th week's? No, 14th week? 15th week. We only have next week for the final, right? So this was back on week one. Do you remember ring strain or not at all? Not really. Well, the final's coming up, so it's good to review. I like to review every day, so even though it seems like it would take a lot of time, it doesn't, because pretty soon you memorize so much stuff that it goes by very fast. You know, the early stuff's already been memorized. And that gives more time. But it has to do with how many member, three-membered, four-membered, five-membered. What's a sweet number or stability? What? How many membered ring do we need for decent stability? When I talk about membered, this is a 1, 2, 3, 4-membered ring. Is a 4-membered ring stable? Now, what are the bond angles in the 4-membered ring? 90 degrees. What's sp3 supposed to be? Yeah, it's 109.48. 47, and so I'm going to just round it to 109. If I did one more digit, it would round to 109.5 because the 4 would be rounded up. And so a lot of people will just say 109 degrees. This causes stress. Are you going to have good overlap? You know, we're going to use valence bond. If we use valence bond, are we going to have good overlap here? You know, the sp3 orbitals are pointed at 109, but these are trying to bond at 90. Is it going to be a good straight-on overlap, or is it going to be kinked? When we overlap the atomic orbitals, they should be on overlapping straight-on. You know, so proper overlap would be, this would be an sp3, and then this would be an sp3 sigma bond. And so sp3 and sulfur, sulfur is bigger, much bigger, to an sp3 and oxygen, which is much smaller. Is that good? That's good overlap if it's straight on like this. But if you had an sp3 orbital like this, you know, and then the sp2 orbital is coming at a weird angle, I mean sp3 on oxygen is coming at a weird angle, is that good overlap? And so rather than drawing a bond like this, sulfur, oxygen, we draw a bond like this, sulfur, kink, oxygen. Do we draw kinks in our bonds, single bonds? No. This is not good. Anyway, that's our part of our final review here, since this is back from week one.
Was the sweet spot like 6 members?
No. Zane, do you remember the sweet spot? 5. 5-membered ring. 5-membered ring, there's no ring strain, and then the orbitals can overlap. properly. Four-membered and three-membered are bad. It's not that they can't form. Four-membered ring forms, like in cyclobutane, but, you know, that's going to alter its properties. Let's take a look at cyclobutane. So it's actually, you can actually form this. It's commercially available as a liquefied gas. But it's probably used in, take a look how tweaked this is. Do you see that? The structure of that? The bond angles between carbon atoms are significantly strained and as such have lower bond energies than related linear or unstrained hydrocarbons, such as butane or cyclohexane. As such, cyclobutane is unstable above about 500 degrees C. So this will seem to last to about 500 degrees C. It's kinked like this. They call these like chair and boat. This would be like a boat type configuration here, or butterfly. This is butterfly. Have different names for these things. But, you know, something like this is used in synthesis, you know, like here. Carboplatin is a popular anti-cancer drug that is derived from cyclobutane 1,1 dicarboxylic acid. Yeah. It's strained, and so let me be. What do you think cyclopropane would be, worse or better? Oh, I don't have. Cyclopropane is going to be worse. Propane with no M. It's going to be worse. This is highly strained, 60-degree angles here. Cyclopropane was discovered. Who proposed it? It was synthesized because this isn't stable. And so it was discovered as something that was synthesized. The triangular structure of cyclopropane requires the bond angles between carbon-carbon covalent bonds to be 60 degrees. 34 kilocalories per mole versus ordinary carbon-carbon bonds. Kilocalories I'm not familiar with. I just do joules, so if I need to figure out how many joules that is, because I have the bonds. Do you have bond some bond energies memorized? Like around the weakest to the strongest? Just rough numbers. You don't need to know the exact numbers. Well, let me first go to joules. So it's 34 times 4.184 joules per calorie, 142. It's 142 kilojoules per mole. It's not the weakest. You know, there are weaker bonds. Do you know what are weaker bonds than 142 kilojoules per mole? About the weakest bond, this is back in Chem 1A, looking at the bond energies chart. The weakest bond was in the 60s, I think it was 67, something like that. And that was like for a peroxide. What were the weakest bonds? The peroxide bond was very weak, perhaps the weakest. Iodine bond is quite weak, too. Those bonds are easily broken by light, visible light. Visible light has enough energy to break those bonds. The strongest bond was about how much? That one was a little easier to remember. The strongest bond was 1,000 kilojoules per mole. Why do we want to know some bond energies? We want to know some bond energies so we can figure out, you know, things like stability and reactivity with light and this kind of stuff. You know, nitrogen-nitrogen bond is not going to be broken by light. And then we want to know, like, the edge of violet's 390 nanometers and the edge of red 760, and we can calculate, you know, how many joules using, you know, photon energies, E equals H nu, this kind of stuff. So we need to have some numbers as reference points, guide points. Like, so that if somebody makes a ridiculous claim, you know, oh, you know, I drove 1,200 miles an hour to get to home today. And then you go, 1,200, you know, something's wrong, right? Well, people do this all the time in science. People who don't know numbers at all, they'll make, you know, they'll say something, and then all of a sudden someone goes, wow, that's a ridiculous number. But they have no clue because they don't know any numbers. I saw this happen at a conference once where the presenter was presenting a number, and the number was a ridiculous number. I mean, it couldn't be, but they didn't realize it, so a question came in from the audience. But it didn't click for some reason. This happened at UCSB when I was there. So you want some numbers, you know. It doesn't mean you memorize a whole bond energy chart. But, hydrogen bonds are about 25 kilojoules per mole to break. Those aren't even considered real bonds. And so even though this is highly strained, we don't expect this to be very stable. And it's not very stable, but it has some stability, 150. You just have to be careful with it, just like hydrogen peroxide or something like that. But it's quite reactive because of this, quite reactive compared to propane. You know, propane's already reactive in terms of redox. Let's see, let me just go back. Well, there are a few other things I need to say about this. Save this. So sulfate is a monodentate ligand here because due to the strain, you know, this is a compromise. It's a trade-off. The more bonds, the more stability. Remember, bond formation is exothermic. Bond breakage is endothermic. Thermodynamics say they're equal and opposite. And so, of course, one of the things is the more bonds, the better. But you have to worry about, are there enough orbitals? Are they going to be strained? You know, steric hindrance? Of course, we'd like to form more bonds to chromium. How many bonds to chromium are we forming here? What's the coordination number? Seven? No. This chloride is outside the coordination sphere. It's just what's in the square bracket. So six. Coordination number six. This is six monodentate ligands. What's this one called? NH3? As a ligand. Amine? With one M or two M's? Two M's. And then what's this called as a ligand? SO4, 2-. Sulfato. And then chromium must be +3 because we have one chloride. This is just called a chloride. This is not a chlorido. Why? Yeah, it's not directly bonded to chromium. This is just an ionic compound with complex cation and the regular anion. This is called pentamine sulfato chromium 3. That's the cation. All one word, chloride. Versus this one. In this one, the chlorido, it's no longer a counterion, it's a ligand. So this is pentamine chlorido. It goes alphabetical, A, S, A, C. Chromium 3, sulfate. This is no longer a sulfato, that's a sulfate. This is, would be a, an example of, now, Petrucci has a name for this one, but we don't really care. This is an example of a structural isomer. You know, the skeleton is totally different. They're going to have different properties because of that. But what does he call this one? In fact, I can't even remember what he calls this one. Exchange isomer or something? Okay. Let's take a look at this one. On the cation, we have amine, so it's cobalt with hexamine, cobalt 3 in this case. The anion has the cyanidos. This is hexacyanido chromate 3. Over here, we switch. And so now the cation is the amines and the cobalt has the cyanide. So actually, we switch the metals, sorry. Cobalt and chromium exchange places. Totally different skeleton. And so this is another example of structural isomer. He has a special name for this one, but we don't need to know the name. We're not dealing with these all the time. If we were dealing with these all the time, then we'd want to break it down, you know, into names. Did I chop off? I guess I chopped that off. Let's see if I shrink this down. Now this one is kind of weird because if you look at it, this is a cobalt. This is NO2 here, and this is a cobalt. This is NO2 also. I remember the name for this one. Do you know what kind of isomer this is? Because here, the skeleton doesn't really look different. We have a cobalt with a nitrite and 5 amines. We call it nitrito. We call it nitrito because of the it's a ligand. Do you need this? No problem. Thank you so much. This might be it. This is also nitrite. NO2 is a nitrite. And so we have a cobalt with 1 nitrite and 5 amines. A cobalt with 1 nitrite, 5 amines. What's the difference? Yeah, the skeleton's different, and that's because nitrito can either bond with the nitrogen or can bond with the oxygen. And so what he calls these, this is the only one I remember, he calls these linkage isomers. Linkage isomers are common, so that's why I remembered linkage isomer. There are a number of examples of linkage isomers. You would think something like cyanide would be an example. We'll talk about that. But let's look at nitrite as a ligand here. So let me talk about linkage isomers. Okay, these are structural as well. So the properties are going to be quite different. The skeleton's different. And so if we look at the metal, what was the metal here? Cobalt. The amines will just be normal, but cobalt, there are 2 ways we can bond nitrite to this. If we do the Lewis structure for nitrite, there's resonance form for nitrite. Let's look at the charge here for nitrite. What's the formal charge on this nitrogen over here? What are the formal charges here? this oxygen, what's the formal charge on this? This is terminal oxygen. These are the two examples of a terminal oxygen. You have a terminal oxygen with a double bond and terminal oxygen with a single bond. What's the formal charge on the double oxygen with a single bond?
Minus.
Minus. Just say minus. Formal charges we don't put in the one, like minus one. For oxidation states, we would say the one. What's the nitrogen? Zero. What's this oxygen over here? This oxygen is also zero. And so what we have here is this. We have one more resonance form for this. What's the other resonance form going to look like? We just swap the positions of the bonds. And so the true structure is a resonance hybrid in which each bond is the same, exactly the same. And the bond order is 1.5. But when we do these Lewis structures, we don't do that. You know, that's what we're going to do is just going to pick one. And so imagining this as the structure, which oxygen is better base? The left oxygen here or the right oxygen here? Which one's a better base? Lewis base. Yeah, this one would be a better electron pair donor. This oxygen is weaker because it doesn't have as much negative charge density, so we'd ignore this oxygen. But in reality, both oxygens are the same. And then the other base that's present is nitrogen. So we have option one is we could bond this. And then option two is this one. Instead of bonding the oxygen here, we bond the nitrogen here. Can we bond both? That is, could this be a bidentate ligand? Yes or no?
No.
No. Why? Not four-membered. If both those bond, it'd make a three-membered ring. It's not going to happen. It'll be much more stable as a monodentate ligand, not a bidentate ligand. And so it's either or. It's one or two. It can't be both. Either one or two. Well, actually, both occur. If one occurs, then we form this. Actually, both can occur. And so if the oxygen binds here, then we end up with something like this. Just throw this as a bridging. Bridging's bent, the geometry. Yeah. So make some room. I'll draw it like this. In complexes, we treat the nitrite as still being nitrite. And the cobalt is still being cobalt 3. And so we do weird stuff. So this is cobalt 3. This is nitrite minus. And so 3 plus minus 1 gives us plus 2. And the same thing here. This is cobalt 3, and this is nitrite with a 1 minus. That's what we do for this. And so we count things strangely in complexes. Now, for organic chemists, though, this is what we call a nitro substituent. So if we look at something like this with nitro substituents on here, then we count things normally. Remember, for complexes, we have to use molecular orbital theory. Otherwise, things just don't quite work. And so we kind of ignore it. You know, this whole nitrite, we ignore it. But over here, we don't ignore. Nitrogen ends up with a positive formal charge. We don't do the same thing here. Nitrogen would end up with a positive formal charge here. And the cobalt would go from 3 to 2. But as I mentioned way back in week 1, we don't do that with complexes. We count the electrons very strangely. But we're missing out on some of the properties. So for example, do you know what this molecule here is called? What nitro groups are bonded to is toluene. So we call this tri-nitro because there are 3 nitro groups bonded there. Tri-nitro-toluene. Have you heard of tri-nitro-toluene before? You might have heard it before because they abbreviate it. They abbreviate TNT. TNT is the ingredient in dynamite. Actually, trinitrotoluene is a liquid and was so explosive that it was so unstable. It was like a gamble, you know, is it going to explode in your hand or not? And so what Nobel did, who started the Nobel Prize, was he made a stable form of it. And so he stabilized TNT by mixing it with something and the TNT absorbed. I forgot. It's been a while since I read it. I did remember it, but my memory's going bad. And I haven't reviewed that. The only way I can remember things is if I review it regularly. Otherwise, forget it. So the property of this is you have 3 of these electron-poor nitro groups on an electron-rich toluene. So you have strong oxidizer and strong reducer all in the same compound. This is what makes it so unstable. So you just need something to get it going, and then it explodes by itself. But we can see, you know, that the nitro groups are going to be electron poor. You know. We can see this by either the formal charge or by the oxidation state. The oxidation state's fine, too. Here we don't necessarily look at those kinds of properties for these complexes. This turns out to be a very stable bond here, the cobalt nitrogen. In fact, it turns out that nitrogen is usually a better base than oxygen. As far as ligands go, you know, this is probably more stable. Nitrogen is typically better. Donor atom. For metal complexes. In order to figure out in these Lewis acid-base reactions what the best combination of donor atom and acceptor atom are, is you would need to look at what? You'd need to look at HSAB. And so we come up with this, we come up with something called the spectrochemical series. The spectrochemical series is something like this. What are some of the best ligands? Some of the best ligands are like carbon monoxide and cyanide. Do these form linkage? It turns out that carbon monoxide and cyanide do not form linkage because what we see for these is one of these atoms is much better than the other as being a base. It's totally lopsided. And so if we're looking at the donor atom, which one do you think, carbon versus nitrogen, which one would be a better donor atom? You would think the nitrogen is, but it turns out it's the carbon. Carbon is way, way better than nitrogen. Why? Because look at the formal charges. What are the formal charges here? Tell me the formal charge on this carbon here and the formal charge on this nitrogen here. Plus for the carbon? No, unfortunately, plus is not right for the carbon. Minus one for the carbon. We just call it minus for formal charges. What's the formal charge on nitrogen?
Zero.
So cyanide is an ion, and it's got a negative charge. Right? So usually with Lewis structures, we draw square brackets and then show the total charge on the outside. And the total charge is the sum of the formal charges. It's also equal to the sum of the oxidation states as well. The oxidation state on the carbon is also negative. Or is it? Yeah. Okay, what are the formal charges in carbon monoxide? Yeah, and for the oxygen? Yeah. This is very unusual. Why? Well, the one thing is carbon monoxide is going to be neutral because when you sum up the formal charges, they add up to zero. So carbon monoxide is neutral. It's very unusual. Carbon monoxide is very unusual because, and also carbon cyanide is very unusual because. Well, the triple bond is the reason why it becomes unusual. The triple bond is to get the octet rule to work. If we didn't triple bond it, we aren't going to get an octet on both. So we need a triple bond there. If we did a double bond, the formal charges would be better in carbon monoxide. If I did a double bond for carbon monoxide, it would be better for oxygen, but not for carbon. I mean, carbon still, what's the formal charge on carbon?
Zero.
And the formal charge on oxygen?
Zero.
So oxygen would be happier, right? Because it has a zero versus a positive. But who would be unhappy? Why would carbon be unhappy? This formal charge is zero. No octet. Octet rule takes precedence. This is review Chem 1A. Anyway, but that's it. And so this one, in order, the octet rule, for it to be satisfied, we need this. In chemistry, this happens. So as you go on in chemistry, you use the stuff you used in the past. It just kind of builds up. It's not all new. So the next class after this, which would be like either physical chem, well, organic as well. Organic, a lot of these concepts, you know, pop up again. Valence bond theory, MO theory, formal charges, oxidation states. It's all the same stuff. You know, Lewis acid, organic chemistry is full of Lewis acid base reactions, you know, electron pair donor, acceptor, this kind of stuff. And so it's not totally different. It's a lot of the same stuff. And that's the chem. So, you know, you hear it again, you hear it again, you hear it again. You get repetition that way, but the better repetition is more frequent repetition. Kind of a gap there. And so as I mentioned earlier, you know, the organic chemists want to make sure that people leaving Chem 1B and Chem 1A know what valence bond theory is. Apparently, you know, they're getting a lot of students who don't even know what that is, which isn't good, of course. You need to know the orbitals and that kind of stuff. So you got to review it, otherwise it's easy to forget the stuff, for sure. But going back to this, okay, both of these could be donors, right? But this is going to be so lopsided. There's no contest here. Electron pair donor in carbon monoxide, who's going to win? The carbon or the oxygen? Which one's a better base? The carbon. Bases typically are electron pair donors. Electron pairs are negative. Negatively charged electron clouds. If you look at that oxygen is going to be really bad. Really bad as a donor. However, you know, oxygen normally is a pretty good donor, but not in this case. Look at cyanide. Normally, nitrogen is way better than carbon as a donor, but in this case, there's no contest. Who's going to win? Carbon. And so in these cases, we don't expect linkage. Linkage is when either, you know, or situation. It's either carbon or oxygen can bond. You know, it's monodentate. And the same thing in cyanide. Either carbon or nitrogen, but in this case, there's no either or. It's going to be carbon. It's going to be carbon because it's going to be way better. And so the best ligands for transition metals is carbon, carbon donors. This is a carbon donor. A donor has to have a lone pair. If it's a normal carbons don't have a lone pair. These are called carbanions in a way, you know, even though. And so carbon donor is the best. It's going to be the strongest Lewis base. Okay, then oddly enough, nitrogen comes next. You might have thought oxygen would come next because it would seem oxygen would be a better donor than nitrogen. Things like this, ammonia. And then after that, we have the oxygen donor, things like water. Even hydroxide, you know, you would think hydroxide being a powerful Bronsted base would also be a powerful Lewis base. Hydroxide versus water, what one would be better? Hydroxide or water? As a Bronsted base, no contest, hydroxide. As a Lewis base, hydroxide still would be better. It's got a negative charge. Hydroxide should be better. However, hydroxide versus ammonia, oddly enough, who wins? Ammonia wins. Ammonia being better than hydroxide is weird, isn't that? To me, that's very weird because, you know, hydroxide has a full negative charge. Ammonia only has a partial negative charge. Oxygen is smaller than nitrogen, and so the charge density is even higher on oxygen than nitrogen. And so it's weird. But in order to better understand these Lewis acid base reactions, we don't base it on Bronsted. We base it on what? Lewis, which it involves HSAB. And since most of the metals are, you know, kind of similar, not all, like heavy metals and that kind of stuff are a little different. You know, heavy metals like sulfur a lot, you know, because heavy metal ions are typically soft and sulfur is soft. So sulfur is an excellent ligand for heavy metals. And so like mercury spills, they have a cleanup kit which has sulfur in it and sprinkle sulfur on the mercury, that kind of stuff. Halide donors aren't that great, like chloride, et cetera. These are the weakest. So we have something called ligand strength. So these ones would be strong ligands, as they're excellent Lewis bases. And over here we have weak ligands. So when we go back to this linkage isomer up here, I would suspect the this linkage to be better than this linkage over here. And the difference in the linkage is we call this one hyphen O nitrito. This is to indicate the oxygen's bonded. Over here, we call this hyphen N nitrito. But actually, you know, there's not a huge difference. It could be an O nitrito, or it could be an N nitrito, you know, bonded to the central metal. And then we'll have other ligands. You know, cobalt typically forms six coordinate complexes. There's going to be a little bit more steric hindrance. Steric hindrance is kind of bulk around there, you know. Maybe we could try to put seven ligands, but trying to put seven ligands on cobalt would be favorable because each extra bond we make is exothermic, so it leads to lower energy stability. But then we have the steric hindrance and other stuff that impact it, and so we max out about six. There are some complexes where you can actually go seven coordinate. Those are called monocapped octahedral complexes and higher. But we are not going to get into that in this. So this is, since we had chapter 24 at the beginning, now we're coming back. So I wanted to remind you about not counting formal charges like we did and counting it weird. Let's look at cyanide. Now, cyanide has some variations that could be linkage isomers. So cyanide itself, for sure, is not. You know, Cn minus is monodentate. And it's monodentate, and it is going to be only carbon. Monodentate carbon donor. But we have some weird variations. The weird variation would be this one, OCN. OCN also has a negative charge. Did you guys have to memorize this in Chem 1A? I don't make my Chem 1A students memorize this. This anion. But this particular anion could be either, you know, an oxygen donor, or it could be a nitrogen donor. It's also monodentate because this one would form a four-membered ring if both donated. Four-membered ring would be too highly strained, so it's going to be monodentate. And carbon, I mean not carbon, the carbon can't donate here. Do you know why the carbon can't donate? So if we draw the Lewis structure for this, the carbon can't donate because why? Yeah, there's no lone pair. It's not going to donate. And so here, it looks like which one would you suspect would be the best? So based on structure and based on charge density, I would say oxygen would be a better one. But, you know, we aren't accounting for HSAB, you know, and those type of things. And it turns out that, you know, even though I'm leaning towards oxygen being better, it's most likely which one's a better donor, the nitrogen. And so people just kind of memorize the spectrochemical series. The spectrochemical series is carbon donors the best, halides are the worst. And so it could very well be nitrogen's better. It just forms better molecular orbitals, you know. Do it or something, you know. And so oxygen donor or nitrogen donor, but not both because of the ring strain. And so we need to name these different. If oxygen links to the metal, we would form, let's take cobalt again. Cobalt's very common. We'd form something like this. You know, a bridging oxygen is bent. Remember that it's sp3, and so it would bridge and then form this. This is straight because this is sp. It's linear, 180. If it's a nitrogen donor, it just comes straight on like this. remember, we don't mess with the charges. So even though this oxygen, bridging oxygens are neutral, you know, the formal charge is zero, but we're still going to call it what? Negative, because we don't mess with the charges, with the complexes. This is wrong in a way, but it's right in another way, because we're trying to describe the complexes using valence bond theory, but valence bond theory does not work for complexes, as I mentioned. Valence bond theory does not work. We have to use the full quantum mechanical treatment, which is called molecular orbital theory, for this. And so even though the charges, all the formal charges, are all messed up, we leave it all messed up. For organic molecules, valence bond works quite well. And we use it all the time. It's much easier. MO works, of course, even better, but it's much more difficult, and we can't get simple answers, quick, simple answers from that. All right, so what do we call it? When this is bonded as a ligand, this is called cyanate. Now, normally, 8 means it's an oxyanion, and in this case, it is. Cyanate. It's an oxyanion. And so this is very simply named what? Hyphen O hyphen cyanate O. So this is O cyanate O. This one would be called hyphen N hyphen cyanate O. Now, these are linkage isomers. These are structural isomers. So the properties are going to be quite a bit different because the bonding skeleton's totally different. And so this is another example of structural isomerism. We can have an O-cyanato or an N-cyanato, just like an O-nitrito and an N-nitrito. Now, I don't make you memorize cyanate, but lots of instructors do make you memorize cyanato and one more ligand. Cyanato is an excellent ligand. Cyanide is an excellent ligand. Cyanide is a super excellent ligand for a lot of ones. So like gold mining operations, they're using cyanide to leach out gold from mine tailings. Mine tailings are all the garbage that comes out of the mine. But there's, you know, trace amounts of gold in there. They want to capture all the gold. These cyanide pits. I was told that, you know, because I was a geology major, we went on a geology field trip out to past Mojave. Have you been to Mojave, California, off the 14? On the way out there, there's a gold mine, and there's these leaching pits. And apparently, the leaching pits had cyanide in there. And sometimes the wind would blow, you know, people were concerned it's blowing cyanide. You know, cyanide gets maybe in little droplets of water or something gets blown across the highway, so people inhaling cyanide. You know. So they covered all the leaching pits. So if you drive up the 14, you take a look on the left there, I think they're all covered. Yeah, so that wasn't an issue, but apparently that was an issue back in the past. But cyanide's an excellent ligand. Cyanate's a good ligand as well. Well, if we're going to memorize this, then, you know, we try to memorize patterns. And so Do you guys know the thio-8 pattern? Thio-8 pattern. So sulfate is a oxyanion, sulfate. So it's easy to determine what thiosulfate is if you know the pattern. What is thiosulfate? Yeah. So we remove one oxygen. And so we remove one oxygen, it gives us three oxygens. And we replace that oxygen with what? A sulfur. So it comes out S2O3. So here, everything else is the same because sulfur and oxygen are in the same family. So what we end up with is, rather than having a O there, we'll throw in an S there and then keep the other stuff the same. So I'm going to do the octet one, not the expanded octet one for thiosulfate. A thiosulfate, typically in the expanded octet, will have two double bonds of the oxygen, and then this would be a single bond. Thiosulfate, though, is an excellent ligand. What do you think bonds in thiosulfate, though, versus sulfato? Sulfato, the oxygen bonds. In thiosulfato, as a ligand, is this going to be an oxygen donor or a sulfur donor? And if it's a sulfur, it can't be the middle one because the middle one has no lone pair, so it's got to be the terminal sulfur. This is what we call central sulfur atom. So will it be the oxygen or with the sulfur or either or just one? One's much better than the other. It turns out it is the sulfur. Yeah, it's a S donor. But you're thinking, man, maybe the O donor should be better. But based on Bronsted, for sure the O would be better. But based on Lewis, you can't be so certain. And it turns out that thiosulfato is an S donor. But should we do thiosulfato O and thiosulfato S? And so let's take a quick swing and take a look at thiosulfato ligand. Well, let's just read this. This is from Science Direct. Thiosulfate anion, S2O32 minus, is a versatile ligand because of the combination of soft sulfur and hard oxygen. Why do they call it soft sulfur? And why do we care about soft and hard? Yeah, HSAB. And so sulfur loves it would love to find soft metal cations. And soft metal cations, one of the best ones are the heavy metals. The heavy metals are considered soft cations. And so sulfur, again, loves heavy metals. And so, and its ability to act as both a chelating agent and a bridging ligand. A bridging ligand, what the heck is that? A chelating agent is typically what? A monodentate, bidentate, polydentate. Chelating agents are going to be, well, we could call polydentate, all of them, polydentate. So maybe this one might actually be not a monodentate because of the four-membered strain, but a bidentate. You see, this is bidentate, but what I just said about the four-membered ring here tricky, and it's because sulfur, thiosulfate is also inexpensive and non-toxic. Some thiosulfate complexes of the coinage metals are very well known. For example, gold, the gold complex here of thiosulfate, in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. The source of thiosulfate ligand in nickel, palladium, and platinum complexes containing bidentate chelating thiosulfate is quite varied. And so apparently it is bidentate. Now let's take a look at sulfate as a ligand. Well, actually, we should just go with our book. I have to log into our book again. Let's see what our book says about this. Why am I not? So we're out again in chapter 24. Let's take a look at ligands.
What do they call the sofito? They call it a monodentate ligand. But apparently it's okay with the four-membered ring.
How about sulfato? You know, sulfur is a much bigger atom, so that could alleviate some of the stress. You know, this just the size of the bond length. We call it bond length, maybe the size. Let's see if there are very many examples of sulfato. Now, there are two spellings for sulfate. We have the the English and the American English spelling. We use the American English spelling with the F rather than the PH. And so we're looking at sulfato ligand. And one of the questions comes up, is sulfato a bidentate ligand or monodentate ligand? The sulfate ligand can adopt two terminal, monodentate or bidentate. And so I guess it all depends on the strain being different, dictating whether it goes mono or bi. Here. But thiosulfate, that can be bi. We'd expect a difference. Here, your book is going to call them both monodentate, and this is because of the ring strain. Otherwise, you know, this, like, nitrito could be a bidentate, you know, the two oxygens as well. And so there's going to be some analysis. So things are a bit more complex than appear. These are just based on observations. You can make predictions based on this. Okay, but what we see with thiosulfato is, you know, is there an O, thiosulfato O and a thiosulfato S? Well, if it's bidentate, it's got to be, you know, the S and the O. But apparently, the S has got to be much better, otherwise they'd have it like this for these two. There's one more set of linkage, and that's with this. So let's talk about the next set of linkage ones here. And this is the thio-8 pattern. And so let's take a look at the patterns here. Cyanide, CN minus. Cyanate. What's the formula for cyanate? 8 means there's got to be a oxygen. So OCN minus. And thio-cyanate is what? SCN minus. Now, we got to think, is this going to be a bidentate, an S and an N, or a monodentate? Could this be a bidentate ligand? And you're thinking, maybe I should search it, but I already know it's not. Why? This one for sure is not going to be a bidentate ligand. Do you know why? This one is not going to be bidentate because the nitrogen is not going to be as good of a donor. I mean, I suppose it could, but the ring strain is going to be too big. But this one for sure is not going to be bidentate. Can you tell me why? I could think, you know, nitrogen is a good donor. And oxygen, it has a negative charge. That should be a good donor, decent donor. And so why is this not going to be bidentate? It's linear, right? This is linear, whereas sulfate's tetrahedral and thiosulfato's tetrahedral. So this can come in, this would be too far away to get, and then this is SP orbital. The SP orbital is pointing in the wrong direction. You know, it's got to be pointed towards some kind of central point out here. So there's no way this can happen based on valence bond theory. But remember, complexes use MO theory. But still, with MO, you need good, you know, with MO, we need good LCAO. What was LCAO again? Yeah, we need good linear combination. That would be very bad combination of atomic orbitals. So thiocyanato is going to be a monodentate, and it's going to be the S or the N. In this case, N is excellent, but S is also excellent. S isn't on our spectrochemical series, but it's an excellent soft ligand atom. And sulfur is a great donor atom here. And so as far as ligands go, we can bond the S. Okay, let's draw out the whole structure here. So SCN structure is going to look like just like OCN, except we replace O and S are in the same family, so we just replace the O with an S. So we get this. So depending on which one we bond, we're going to get the hyphen S hyphen thiocyane thio. Thio is spelled T-H-I-O. Cyanato. Or the N. And N's an excellent ligand. Second best according to spectrochemical, but sulfur is not placed in there. And because of the structure, let's say we take cobalt and we look at thiocyanato. This would be a thiocyanato S. We can do the same thing with cyanato too. We're going to have the O cyanato and the N cyanato. And I would suspect the N cyanato to be better than the O cyanato because N is better in the spectrochemical series based on observations. And to understand it more theoretically, we would need to look more deeply at the bond formation here. So this is going to be bridging. So this is going to be kinked here. I have it linear, but it's not linear. It's going to be bent at 109. Undistorted. And distorted would be bent. Now sulfur is a lot bigger. You'd expect it to be sp3, but sulfur is so big that, you know, why do we hybridize? We hybridize to minimize electron-electron repulsions. But sulfur is so big that those don't necessarily have to be minimized. So sulfur typically doesn't hybridize. Sulfur goes with unhybridized orbitals. This is mentioned in Petrucci. So some of the bond angles are kind of weird. Like, you know, the angle between p orbitals is 90 degrees. So in H2S, the bond angle is closer to 90 degrees than it is closer to 109. You know, we'd expect the bond angle to be 109 because it's sp3 on the sulfur, but sulfur is so big the electron-electron repulsions are minimal. So the bond angle is closer to 90 than 109. You know, when we have bridging oxygen, it's a little closer to 105, you know, bond angle here. But we'll still draw it like this because we're not going to get into it that deep. And then this is going to come straight out like this. So it's going to be kind of funky like this. Now, we can't have a 180 because the p orbital lobes are going to be 180 apart. But you can't bond two things to one p orbital. And so 180 is not going to happen here. So this would be a hyphen S thiocyanato. And we could bond other ligands to here. And this is going to cause some kind of potential steric hindrance, you know. And so it depends on how bulky our other ligands are. And so cobalt likes to form octahedral complexes. And so we'll have other ligands bonded to this. for example, we could have five amines and one S-thiocyanato. And the N-thiocyanato, we just reverse the ligand. And these are, again, linkage isomers, because linkage isomers are kind of common. And so this, again, the reason why I remember that. For if N-bonded, it looks quite a bit different. What would be different if N-bonded rather than S-bond? Yeah, it wouldn't be bent exactly. Now, we could have other ligands on here as well. It doesn't have to be octahedral. What other kinds of complexes do we have? Cobalt just likes to form octahedral complexes. We try to maximize the number of bonds. We also have square planar complexes and tetrahedral complexes and linear complexes. And so there are others. Those aren't all the structures there. So can you guys check out a model kit? Here, and then I don't. Pause this. It's interesting here that, do you see cyanato? Cyanato? No. We see cyanide, and then we see thiocyanate. So sulfur is just a much better ligand than the oxygen, nitrogen, and cyanato, although we do expect cyanato to be okay as well. But it's just not shown. It's just a limited table. So let's go ahead. Let's go ahead and build thiocyanato S and thiocyanato N. Actually, they're the same thing. And so when we build this, this is how we're going to build this. what we're going to do is for sulfur, let's use blue. And then just put one bond there, and then leave the three holes open for the lone pairs, you know. And then we'll go to black for carbon. For the black for carbon, connect the sulfur, and then get three long sticks and put it in the opposing holes for the carbon. And then for the nitrogen, use a blue, and then attach three long sticks from carbon to the nitrogen to make the triple bond.
Wait, nitrogen is red?
No, nitrogen blue.
What color is sulfur?
Sulfur, we're using blue as well, but probably should have used red for sulfur, because red's for oxygen. It's in the same family. But the only reason I didn't is because I wanted to show the three lone pairs there. But we could use a red one there, too. You'll just have to, what else do we have that has four holes in a tetrahedral?
Yellow.
Oh, okay, use yellow for sulfur, sorry. In fact, the yellow seems appropriate for sulfur, because elemental sulfur is most common. It's a yellow sulfur. Okay, there you have it. And so what we can do is, for the sulfur, just we'll put in one stick for the metal ligand bond, and then get the silver one, and attach it. So do you see the kinked arrangement? It's kinked because of the lone pairs, right? Okay, and then, okay, remove that, and then put one stick on the blue nitrogen, and then attach it. Yeah, do you see the total difference in geometry there? Right? And so we have the what we call the thiocyanato N. Actually, I should have written it. Thiocyanato N. The linkage goes after. I've been misdoing these. Thiocyanato N. Let me write it here. The ligand would be thiocyanato hyphen N. And this would be the thiocyanato hyphen S. At the end, sorry. I've been writing at the beginning, but it doesn't really make a huge difference. It should go at the end. Here. Thiocyanato N, thiocyanato S. The structure looks a little different. And again, this is not going to be bidentate ligand because of the tweak structure, whereas something like thiosulfato is potentially a bidentate ligand here, but it would form a four-membered ring. Four-membered rings can form, like cyclobutane, and three-membered rings can form, like cyclopropane. They're just less stable. So those compounds actually exist. The same thing here. You would expect this to have lower stability, but sulfur is quite big, so maybe it's okay. Whereas sulfato probably wouldn't be as good. So there are a lot of nuances here, but I try to ignore all the nuances and just get to more of a general feel for it first and then look at the nuances later. And so the general feel is four-membered and three-membered rings are going to be inherently unstable, so that's important to know. All right, let's look at some other ligands here. When we do polydentate, we only had three polydentates, right? The most common one is, what one do you think is a better polydentate, oxalato or ethylene diamine? Okay, based on the spectrochemical series, which one would be better, oxalato or ethylene diamine? Ethylene diamine. So let's build the ethylene diamine. Don't take yours apart right just yet. I think you should have enough atoms to build it separately. So build ethylene diamine for me. Include all the hydrogens in there. Blue is for nitrogen, and then the blacks are for carbon. Whites are going to be for the hydrogens. And then it's going to be a nitrogen donor, and it's going to be bidentate, and it's going to form a five-membered ring, which is going to show a lot less stress. So go ahead and throw an ethylene diamine onto your silver ball. Is there room for an ethylene diamine? That should be. Okay, so we're building oxalate, and then we're going to attach it to the silver. Use red for oxygen. It's bidentate. Bidentate and higher are called chelating agents. So ethylene diamine is a chelating agent. It's hard to break that off because you have to break both bonds off at the same time. If you break one, then and then go to break the other one reattaches. So it just reattaches. So when you break one bond off ethylene diamine, it flops around and then eventually it could reattach. So you got to be quick and break the second one off, or you got to time it just right. But you can't because it's a random collisions.
Can you
at the difference here. One thing is the carbon's sp2 in ethylene diamine, or sp3 in ethylene diamine. The carbon in ethylene diamine is sp2 or sp3. sp3. In oxalato, the carbon is not sp3, it's sp2. Note the difference in structure. Oxalato is what we call a planar structure. It's flat, like a pancake. So is it possible to tetradentate oxalato? Is it possible to tetradentate that rather than bidentate? How would you try to tetradentate oxalato? Is it going to be physically possible? No. It's not going to be possible to tetradentate oxalato. So oxalato, you might consider this a tetradentate. What about bidentate? Could we do a bidentate with, what did you do? Did you do a bidentate with these two oxygens here? Could you bidentate these two oxygens here? Try to bidentate these two oxygens on the same carbon and see what happens. Is that going to work? No, it's not going to work. This is going to be much more strained. This would form a four-membered ring, whereas this is going to form a five-membered ring. So this is going to be much more preferred. So oxalato is not tridentate. It's not tetradentate. It's going to just be bidentate. And how many more spaces do we have left? One. So we could put a monodentate. Give me an example of a monodentate you could throw on there. We could put a cyanato on there. Or we could put, we did thiocyanato, so it looks similar. But you could put a, what's the best donor? Yeah, cyanide or carbon monoxide. The problem we have with those is the red balls only have two holes drilled in them. So what we can do is we can make, let's make a, which one do you want to do, cyanide or carbon monoxide? Okay, let's build a cyanide. The cyanide, we can make a triple bond. So get one black and one blue. Do you have another blue? One black and one blue, put three long bonds on the black or blue and attach them together. And just throw cyanido on there. Which ligand, if you have a strong ligand like that, it has a good strong bonding interaction with the metal, so it's going to be hard to break off. But which ligand do you think is going to be the hardest to break off? Ethylene diamine. Ethylene diamine should be harder to break off than, let's say, oxalato, because nitrogen should be a better donor, right? And it's bidentate. It's hard to break off because, again, if you break one of the bonds, and then go to break this off the second bond, the first bond can reattach because this is flopping around, around there. And so that's it. So we have an oxalato. I mean, naming this would be kind of a pain because, we have so many different ligands on there. But I guess we could name it. But ethylene diamine is an excellent ligand, and oxalato, both are excellent ligands. Those are chelating agents, and those are hard to break off, although cyanido would be an excellent ligand as well, but it's just monodentate. It's not a bidentate ligand. As we talked about before, three-membered ring plus the orientation of the orbitals are, it's sp hybridized, so the orientation of the orbitals are all in the wrong direction. Do you want to try building ethylene diamine tetraacetato? Yes? All right. Try to build ethylene diamine tetraacetato, and let's see. Actually, how many potential donors are there?
So,
I would count, okay, this oxygen's a donor, this oxygen's a donor, so that's two, this nitrogen, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Is this a decadentate ligand, you think? No, it's not going to be decadentate because we can't get these two oxygens. I mean, it would just form a four-membered ring. Four-membered rings are unstable. You know what this is? It's a, not the tetra, it's a hexa, because we bind these two oxygens, see if we can bind this nitrogen without much strain. But remember, nitrogen's even better. In fact, we should start with the nitrogens first because the nitrogens are better. But it's kind of sterically hindered because you got all this other junk on here as well. And so this one's going to be a tough build, but I think you may be able to accomplish it. Let's see. But this one, once EDTA is on there, taking it off is going to be terribly, terribly difficult. And so it's going to form an exceptionally stable, that is, chelate. EDTA has, it's called ethylene diamine, so don't take apart your ethylene diamine because you can use that as the base for your EDTA. It's called ethylene diamine, but rather than having hydrogens attached to the nitrogens, we have four acetate anions attached there. So the whole thing carries a negative charge because ethylene diamine is neutral, but acetate has a negative one charge. So this is ethylene diamine tetraacetato. Try to build that.
The oxygen is yellow, right?
I'm sorry?
The oxygen is yellow.
The oxygen typically is red. Yeah. We use oxygen.
So if you do oxalato, it would be red, black, red. But, for the double bonds, you could put two long sticks there. Those are made for double and single bonding. Blue, or you might not have enough blue ones. You have enough blue ones, right?
Yeah.
Or, actually, any of those, because for the bridging you need to use a red one. For the terminal you could use any anion there, any color, because the terminals are double bond, but you don't have to do double bond, just do a short stick to represent a double bond. Double bonds are shorter. Remember, single bonds are the longest, double bonds are shorter, triple bonds are the shortest. Or just grab another kit. If you don't want to mess with it, just grab another kit and use the red ones. We have enough kits for everything.